So today I want to explain, with just 1% of the federal budget, the State Department and USAID prevents conflicts abroad, promotes prosperity at home, and most importantly, protects the American people. From countering extremism in Yemen, to serving alongside our troops in Iraq and Afghanistan, to train the Mexico's police force to help ensure our southern border, we do every day is what we do is for our national security. I appreciate you inviting me to speak alongside Deputy Secretary of Defense Bill Lynn. The fact that we are presenting our budgets together is a very important first. It speaks to the sense of shared mission that begins with the President, the Secretary of Defense, and the Secretary of State, and extends all the way to the civilians and troops working shoulder to shoulder in Iraq, Afghanistan, and Pakistan. Cooperation between the State and the Department of Defense has never been better. Today, I want to walk you through the investments that allow us to combine diplomacy, development, and defense to advance our national security. This year, for the first time, our request is divided into two parts. The first part is our core budget, our foreign assistance and operation in just about every nation in the world. Our 2012 request is $47 billion, essentially flat from the 2010 levels. The second part is our extraordinary temporary war costs in Iraq, Afghanistan, and Pakistan. This year, for the first time, the President's budget presents our war funding in the same way it funds the Pentagon's, in a separate account called the Overseas Contingency Operation Account, or OCO for short. This more transparent approach distinguishes between the temporary war costs and our enduring budget and reflects a shared effort on the ground. The State Department and USAID's share of the President's OCO account of $126 billion in 2012 is $8.7 billion, which I'll come back to in a moment. Let me start with our core 2012 budget request of $47 billion. It represents a 1% increase over the comparable levels in 2010, less than the rate of inflation. And make no mistake, even without the extraordinary war costs, the core budget should be considered part of the U.S. government's national security budget. It stabilizes conflict zones, it reduces the threat of nuclear weapons, it restores old alliances, it supports democratic transitions, it counters extremism, it opens global markets, and it protects American citizens abroad. And where we are not actively working with the military today, State and USAID are deploying diplomats and development specialists so that the Department of Defense does not have to deploy our troops tomorrow. We're investing in four principal areas. First, we devote $11 billion of our $47 billion core budget to prevent conflict and support fragile states. For example, this budget supports humanitarian and security assistance for the likes of Yemen, crisis diplomacy in Sudan, and rebuilding Haiti. Second, we invest $7.4 billion of our $47 billion core budget to support key allies and partners. This includes over $3 billion for Israel and strong support for our partners on every continent. It also includes military-to-military partnerships in 130 countries across the world, administered by state and implemented by DOD. Third, we invest $14.6 billion of our core budget to advance human security. We have targeted drivers of future conflict, disease, hunger, and climate change. Our largest single investment is $8.7 billion in global health programs, including the continued support for PEPFAR, the program to treat and prevent HIV and AIDS started under George W. Bush. We're also investing $1 billion in food security, $650 million to address climate change, and over $4 billion in emergency humanitarian assistance for victims of war, survivors of natural disasters, and refugees like the hundreds of thousands who have fled Libya in the last few weeks. Fourth, we invest $14 billion to strengthen and sustain our presence across the world. This is an investment of a remarkable group of public servants, and it delivers significant returns to the American people. Our political officers build relationships and promote democracy. Our economic officers fight every day for American companies and jobs. Our development officers spread opportunity and stabilize societies, while our public diplomacy officers tell our story across the world. And our consular officers help average Americans every day. Finally, we have our temporary extraordinary war costs in the frontline states. I'm glad to have Deputy Secretary Lynn here with me because when you consider our two OCO requests together, you come away with a much clearer picture. The Pentagon is saving $45 billion this year on its overall OCO requests from the 2010 levels, largely due to the transition from military to civilian leadership in Iraq.
Tom, if I can just stop you on that point, because we have people listening, and sometimes we use terms here that aren't familiar to the viewing audience. If you'd describe what OCO stands for, because it's going to be continually referenced during this hearing, I think it would help people who might be listening if you could describe what OCO stands for.
Certainly, sir. OCO is basically an ability for us to be able to show the cost of our war funding, which is defined as temporary and extraordinary. As you know, certainly from the State Department and somewhat from DOT, much of our war funding in Afghanistan, Iraq, and Pakistan has been funded by supplementals. And so this year, in 2012, we want to have a fuller picture of what we believe we need to fund the frontline states. So we're separating our core budget from our war cost budget for you all to be able to understand exactly what we define as temporary and extraordinary.
And OCO stands for Overseas Contingency Operations. So
yes, sir.
When people hear this reference, OCO, that stands for Overseas Contingency Operations. It relates to war funding and conflict funding globally.
Yes, sir. So as I was saying, as the Pentagon is saving $45 billion this year on its overall OCO request for 2010, largely due to the transition from military-civilian leadership in Iraq, ours, that of being the State Department, is increasing by $4 billion. And as Secretary Clinton likes to say, every business owner she knows would gladly invest $4 to save 41. In Afghanistan and Pakistan, alongside our military offensive, we are engaged in a major civilian effort to strengthen our partners, undercut the Taliban, and take on al-Qaeda. We're also working to deepen our partnership with the Pakistani people and empower the governments to act on our shared interests in taking on violent extremists. Our OCO request for Afghanistan and Pakistan is $3.5 billion. A few weeks ago, I visited Iraq, and as soldiers pass on the responsibility to civilians, the State Department is ready to lead, but we need the support and the resources to do the job. We have lost too many lives and spent too much money not to see this through. The Iraq portion of our OCO request for state and USAID totals $5.2 billion. Finally, sir, I'd like to address our funding for the rest of 2011. The 16% cut for state and USAID that passed the House last month would put our missions severely at risk. In the frontline states, our efforts would be hollowed out. In the Middle East, we would be forced to scale back exactly at the wrong moment. And finally, we would turn our backs on millions of HIV/AIDS patients, mothers, and children. The American people are right to be concerned about our national debt, and so are we. But they still expect us to make smart investments in the future. And when a crisis erupts, and they always do, they expect us to be ready. This is a moment when America needs to lean forward, not pull back. I look forward to working with you to do what is necessary to keep America safe, strong, and competitive in a changing and dangerous world. Thank you.